Everyone, this is September 22nd, 2020, and at this time, I'm going to call to order the work session of the Maricopa County Community College District Governing Board. For purposes of the record, I'm going to call roll, making a note that Ms. Munoz, our student advisory trustee, is not able to join us for our work session today. With that, I'll start with you, Mr. Hendricks. Are you present?
Present. Present.
Thank you. Ms. McGrath? Okay, great. You're present. Dr. Narini?
I'm presently present.
Mr. Sarr?
I'm here.
Dr. Thor?
Here.
Ms. Nguyen? Okay, I have a note that she's running late. I'm present. This would suggest that there are six members of the board present for this work session. So at this time and today, we are going to hear from the Business Services Department. Dr. Gonzalez, would you like to introduce our presenters, please?
I'm sorry. Can I just jump in right now? We just want to make sure that the person who is live captioning our event is available to run a test for us really quick.
Okay.
So sorry. I'm so sorry.
That's all right. Just tell me when we're ready to go.
Okay. Okay. It seems like the captioner is rebooting the software right now.
Okay. So we'll wait until that's concluded, I assume?
Yes, please. We're reaching out to her right now.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi, it's Mrs. Nguyen. I'm driving home and I'm not there yet.
We're waiting for live captioning, so I'll make note that you're present and change the board count to be seven present, okay. Board members present. And at this time, are we making any progress, Elsa, for us to move forward?
Still checking with her.
Okay.
Sorry, thank you.
Elsa, do you sing? Maybe you could entertain us. With this.
Unfortunately, you do not want to hear me sing. Okay, so I did get a message from the tech department that we can go ahead and start, and if we need to caption the meeting, we can have that available tomorrow until she gets her software going.
Okay, thank you. So with that, we've made note of a full quorum of the board is present, seven members, and also I asked Dr. Gonzalez to introduce our presenters for today from the business services area. Dr. Gonzalez?
Yes, thank you, President Sullivan, and good afternoon, the rest of the governing board members, and to everybody that is listening to the work session. We're going to spend the next hour or so going over some assumptions and some processes and some ideas for consideration related to both the budget process and budget development for the next fiscal year. And I would like to add to that that at least in the time that I've been here, I'm not so sure that we come to the board this early in the process. That was something that you and other board members had asked for previously, and we had committed to doing so to begin this process early so that we could get ahead of some of the conversations that we have and not feel so rushed as we typically do in the latter part of the spring semester on our way to approving a final budget. So we're hoping with an early start that it gives us enough runway to have plenty of conversations on our budget, especially in light of the effects of COVID-19 on our operating budget for the district. And we just look forward to continued engagement and get into a place where we can ultimately approve a budget that has been touched by many hands and had an opportunity to be weighed in by many. So with that said, I'd like to introduce Dr. Jim Moore, who is serving as our interim chief operating officer, and Gary Aquinta, who will also be assisting in this presentation, and they may have others that I'm not aware of at this point, but at least those two will begin. So with that said, I'll turn it over to Dr. Moore.
Thank you, Dr. Go ahead, Mr. Moore.
Thank you, President Sullivan, board members, Chancellor, CEC members and guests. You know, as the Chancellor said, I'm Jim Moore, and I'm the interim chief operating officer for the district. And as Gary and I worked on this presentation, we came up with, you know, we talked with a lot of the senior leadership in the district, and we wanted to make some sort of overarching comments about what to expect from this work session as we move forward. One of the things that we're committed to is developing and building a balanced budget. In the last 3 years, we've had structural deficits, and we're really committed this year to matching our expenses to our revenues. So that will result in a budget decline for 21-22. It'll be reduced by a targeted amount. We're fixing in on that target, and Gary will be sharing with it a little bit later. As we move, you know, through the presentation, we're going to lay out some interactive strategies for accomplishing that goal, which is reducing the budget. And by interactive, I mean as one of these options for reducing the budget is increased, the others can be decreased. So the idea there is for us to arrive at a balanced budget with the least amount of disruption to the primary operations of the district, which is to deliver quality education to our students. So we're very mindful of that. I don't want to leave the impression whenever you say a reduced budget, immediately people think of reduction in force or furloughs. We don't see, at least I don't see at this time, any need for any active positions to be removed from the budget or that have individuals in them. After we have discussed or explained those options, there are a couple of recommendations or suggestions that have come out of a budgeting task force about how to develop the budget in the future, and Gary will be also presenting those. So, you know, with that, we can turn it over to Gary to sort of start to walk us through the presentation itself. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim, President Sullivan, members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez, colleagues and guests. My name is Gary Aquinto. I'm the Chief Financial Officer for the district. And Elza, if we can move to the next slide. So Jim did cover the agenda, and we really have three topics to address. First is the FY21-22 budget development. Next, I'll introduce a two-year budget concept. This is a proposal arising out of the Budget Task Force white paper that was issued this past May. And then the final topic is a very brief description of using attempted credits for planning and budgeting rather than FTSE, which is our shorthand for full-time student equivalents. So next slide, please. Okay, so the theme or guiding principle for the FY22 budget, as Jim described, is to create a balanced budget to ensure financial sustainability in the face of COVID disruptions and lower enrollment. And as will be shown as we move through the presentation, this means reducing budgeted expenditures for all business units. So Elsa, if we could move on to the next slide. So before we dive into more specifics on budget direction, I'd like to propose a schedule for moving forward with additional work sessions with the board as we refine the numbers and move toward a final budget. As the chancellor had indicated, we're early in the process and we want to work collaboratively with all the stakeholders and with the board to arrive at a final budget next year. So we're looking to receive input from board members through these periodic workshops that we can then incorporate into a final budget proposal. So starting with this September workshop, this is a very, very early look at the conditions surrounding the budget for FY22. It's at a very general level, intended really to start the conversation. We're proposing the next workshop for sometime in November, and we intend to cover two items. First is to provide what really is a first look at revenues and expenditures by fund. We'll have more information about how the spring semester is shaping up to inform projections for FY22. And the second item that we'll be bringing to the board in November will be a preview of a five-year interactive budget planning tool so that we can view long-term budget trends based on changing assumptions. And we could do that together and collaboratively at the work session. And then next, we would propose a workshop in January to view updated data on the assumptions and the spending patterns that are occurring this fiscal year across all the funds, and then to make any necessary adjustments before bringing a draft budget document and budget presentation to the board in the March-April time period. At that point, sometime early next calendar year, we should be in a position that most of the details of the FY22 budget will have been discussed and worked out so that we can bring a final budget for the board to approve at its May 2021 regular meeting. Next slide, please, Elsa. Okay, budget assumptions. At this early stage, we're focused on beginning with very conservative assumptions, which can be adjusted up or down as we gain more information about enrollment and other factors affecting the budget. Our goal, again, is to achieve a balanced budget and move away from the structural imbalance that has been created over the past few years, where we invested more in the budget than ongoing revenues coming in the door. We essentially dipped into our reserves to pay for ongoing expenses. And that's a proposition that over the long term is simply not sustainable. So our initial conservative outlook includes a 15% decline in tuition and fee revenue for the entirety of this fiscal year, for the fall and spring and summer sessions into calendar year 21. And then we would remain this lower level of tuition and fees. We would continue it flat at this level in developing our FY22 revenue projections. So based on this assumption, we're projecting the general fund reserve dropping by 80% between the end of fiscal year 20 and the end of fiscal year 22 within our projections. In other words, it could drop to a very low level, even combined with the roughly $70 million in the fiscal sustainability fund that we also sometimes refer to as the rainy day fund. Our initial target is to maintain at least 16% combined reserve, combined general fund reserve at the end of FY22 plus the fiscal sustainability fund of $70 million, roughly $70 million. What that means is that to reach this target, we should reduce budgeted expenditures by some $22 million within the FY22 budget. This would beat the 16% level and provide approximately 2 months of operating budgeted expenditures reserve. This is about 2 months, again, at 16%. And this is actually below best practice, which is to have 3 to 6 months of expenditures set aside in reserve. Bottom line is we're looking for a reduction of between 2% and 4% in budgeted expenditures across all business units, all the colleges and the district office as well. And so before I leave this slide, there certainly are opportunities for increasing revenues to the general fund, either through tuition increases or property tax increases. But at this time, we would propose that these options only be considered after a budget reset and fiscal stability is achieved. Next slide, please. So again, to reinforce and reiterate, two concepts embody what we're trying to achieve. First, financial stability, achieve a structurally balanced budget. And second, safety, the ability to continue operating in the event and in the face of emergencies. Again, our target is 16% of budgeted expenditures in reserve. Next slide, please. So how do we get there? How do we achieve budget reductions of 2% to 4%? So we've got a number of ideas for cost savings that we have been exploring and that we have been sharing with the colleges and with the district offices, beginning with vacancy and salary savings. And there are a couple ideas here that could be pursued. The first is to reduce some positions that have been vacant for 1 year or longer. And we do have a number of those within the district. Second idea is to pause filling non-essential vacant positions. And then the third idea, and this is something that we have been tracking over the last several pay periods, and that is to continue our natural attrition. Fewer paychecks. We have been issuing fewer paychecks over the last few pay periods. And as this continues, we can see that there has been some natural attrition that has resulted in some cost savings. Next idea is to consolidate and reduce memberships and subscriptions. We spend somewhere around $1.6 million in the general fund, out of the general fund, on memberships and subscriptions. We believe there are opportunities to reduce the level of memberships and subscriptions through consolidation and doing away with those memberships and subscriptions that are no longer necessary. And we think that we can achieve savings of somewhere around $500,000 to $600,000 through this measure. Another idea is to adjust our food contract. We do not have food operations at most of our colleges now, and we do pay a management fee to Chartwells. So the idea here would be to seek negotiations with Chartwells to see if we can carve some money out of that management fee that they charge us. Better ideas and facilities. We can look at repurposing, mothballing, or selling buildings and facilities that are no longer fit for purpose or being used. This is going to require some additional research on our part. We've already begun that, but it will require a number of people sitting down and determining what might exist in the way of savings in this category. And then also to renegotiate leases. We do have a few leases that, given the situation, the circumstance, and the drop in our revenues, projected drop in our revenues, that perhaps we can go back and renegotiate some of the leases that we have. Another idea is to slow down or eliminate renewal of certain contracts. And again, we're developing a list and combing through that list to see what, if anything, can be removed. And then the next idea is consolidation of service for efficiency gains. There are things that we do across the district that can be consolidated, we believe, and result in economies of scale and therefore lower our costs, and there are a range of other operational savings and efficiencies that that we can look at. Now, what I'd like to do, President Sullivan, if I might, at this point, since this segment of the presentation is likely to generate some questions, is to simply pause here before we move on and see if there are any questions and attempt to answer those questions.
Thank you, Mr. Jacinto. Board members, there's been a lot put in front of you already. So with that, I'll do the usual just to find out if you have any inquiries at this point. Mr. Hendricks?
No questions.
Ms. McGrath?
No questions.
Dr. Negrini?
Just one quick one about the non-essential vacancies. How do we determine the essentiality? Is that a word? The essentialness of positions.
Thank you, and President Sullivan, Dr. Negrini. The idea here would be to develop a process for approval of filling vacant positions. So that would be a determination made at some level with a justification provided by the hiring entity, the entity that wants to fill that position. So it would be to fill those empty vacant positions with permission by evaluating the essentiality of filling that position.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Saar.
Yeah, regarding consolidation, would one of those possibilities be consolidating our HLC memberships?
That could well be an option. It isn't one that we've specifically focused in on, but to the extent that that opportunity exists, we would certainly pursue it.
Thank you. That's all.
Dr. Thor. Dr. Thor, I'm done. Let me see. Yeah.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, can hear you. Thank you.
Yeah. So thank you, Ms. Sullivan. I do have a number of questions. Most of them, however, I prefer to wait until we've heard the whole presentation. Mr. Jacinto, you mentioned that there was, I believe you called it something like a budget development white paper that was issued in, I think you said May. Did the board receive a copy of that?
Thank you, President Sullivan and Board Member Thor. I do believe we had relatively wide distribution of that. I would have to go back and check as to whether it was distributed specifically to the board. The chancellor might know the answer to that question. And then just to provide a high level introduction to that white paper, it was developed to look at the budget process in its entirety and to better synchronize and integrate the budget development processes that the colleges undertake along with the budget process at the district level. And so there were timelines laid out. There were ideas for how to communicate and collaborate over that time period between the district budget office and the colleges. And then there were a few proposals that came out of that white paper, one of which was that we should give consideration to a two-year budget development process. And the second recommendation, beside the changes in the process, the technical processes, was that we should continue to evaluate and look at the budget reallocation model that has been under development for over 2 years through the transformation project that was presented to the board last year in developing the FY21 budget, but was not fully developed and therefore not approved at that point. And just to conclude, Dr. Thor will certainly make a point of sending that white paper to all the board members.
Thank you. I'd appreciate it because the concept of a two-year budget seems new to me. And so I don't think that we've seen that paper, but I could be wrong.
Any other item right now, Dr. Thor, before I move on?
President Sullivan, while Dr. Thor is thinking out, I'd be happy to provide some additional comment once Dr. Thor asks any additional questions.
Yes, I was going to follow up and ask you, because as I served with Mrs. McGrath on a budget committee, I don't recall seeing one either. So I'm also interested in your answer. So thank you. Could you proceed?
Sure. You may not have received it, and this isn't anything that we've been intentionally held back. Dr. Thor, when I became the interim chancellor, based on my experience as a college president, I think there's nothing more frustrating for college presidents than a broken budget process and a complete misalignment between college campus budgeting processes and a district-wide budgeting processes that had very little alignment and very little collaborative transparency effort. So I formed a task force in the early months of the pandemic. It was disrupted some by the pandemic, and the task was to just simply look at the budget process. And that task force took it a step further. In addition to coming up with some recommendations for process, recommended, as Gary said, you know, the possibility of a two-year budget cycle. So the white paper is simply that. It's a response to the question of, can we do better? And we're certainly willing to share that with you. Again, nothing that we're hiding from you at all on that, but some of what we're doing today in terms of presenting early is a result of that task force's work.
Thank you, Dr. Gonzalez. I think it's important that as those items are produced, that we all have access to them. That certainly it supports then what we hear in tonight's workshop. So as soon as that can be distributed, that would be a good plan. So I'm moving on now to Mrs. Nguyen. Do you have any questions right now?
I like the idea of being ahead of the issue and taking the time. I also like what I heard about real estate being analyzed. And I would just say at this point, I'll look forward to more information, but I like the areas in which Mr. Iaquinto has presented to us to this point. And I think it's encouraging. So thank you.
Thank you. And I have no other questions at this time. My questions have been answered so far. So, Mr. Iaquinto, please go forward.
Certainly. Thank you. Elsa, if we could move on to the next slide. And let's go ahead and move further. One more. Okay. So, two-year budget concept. It is something that other government agencies do. I know that being the budget director for the state, there are a number of agencies for which the state does two-year budgets rather than annual budgets. And the concept is fairly simple, although like many concepts, the devil is in the details and there are many details yet to be worked out. So as an example, and this would be something that would be proposed to begin in developing the FY23 budget. So the way that it would work is as follows. Effective July 1st, in odd number years, beginning with 23, a two-year budget would be developed for year one and year two for the odd numbered year and even numbered year. And in the even numbered years, the budget units at the colleges and at the district office would perform a review of programs and services, perhaps looking at those that can be eliminated or repurposed to do other things. And in the proposal that was developed by the subgroup of the task force, budgets would not be reduced in year two of the two-year cycle, but supplemental funding may be allowed. And again, the devil is in the details. This is something that needs further discussion and evolution before it can be finalized. So Elza, if we can move to the next slide, please. So what are the advantages and disadvantages that have been identified by the subgroup? And when you receive the white paper, you'll see that there's an addendum that more fully lays out the proposal. And in it are these advantages and disadvantages. And I'm not going to go through all of them, but clearly, you know, advantages, well, there's some stability, there's cost and time savings in developing a budget. It enables more long-term planning, less focus on annual process. But at the same time, there are some disadvantages. And one disadvantage is that we would have to make our projections for a two-year period of revenues. And of course, the further out into the future you go and making these guesstimates or projections, the more uncertainty you bring into to that picture. There could be a delay in implementing innovation and new technologies if you're putting together a two-year budget rather than looking at the need for investments in an annual year. Although, as the proposal addresses, there'd be an opportunity for supplemental funding in year two. If revenues happen to increase over that two-year period, the base budgets don't necessarily increase with those increased revenues. So Elza, next slide, please. So as I mentioned, devil is in the details. Now for the third time, we have expanded the two-year subgroup, and that subgroup continues to meet to work out details. And there are many, many issues that need to be addressed, including, you know, do we continue with a carry forward? How do we handle that? Should there be a hold harmless provision built in to the process? How do we integrate the budget equalization model that is continuing to be developed? That's an annual model, and how does it fit with a two-year budget process? And what are the leadership and governing board roles in developing a two-year budget process? That needs to be sorted out and identified and determined. And then finally, budget unit accountability and form of evaluation. That's part of the idea here, but that all has to be specifically identified and detailed to ensure that it does what it is intended to do. And then finally, we're anticipating a final report from the subgroup on the two-year budget concept by the end of this calendar year. Next slide, please, Elza. And then the final topic I want to address, and I'll do so very briefly because this is something that has just recently come up, and it has to do with looking at attempted credit hours rather than our full-time student equivalents when we do internal planning and our internal budget projections. There are a number of external mandates that are prescribed in statute, including spending limits and some other items that require the use of FTSE. So we obviously can't use attempted credits for that purpose, but for our internal planning and budgeting processes, we can. Next slide, please, Elza. So why would we want to look at credit hours rather than FTSE? Well, to begin with, our estimates of basic term FTSE counts does not include credit hours from 8-week courses or open enrollment, open entry, and open exit courses. Now this affects all colleges, but it particularly affects Rio Salado and Scottsdale, where there is a heavier use of 8-week and open entry courses. And by looking only at basic term FTSE, it skews the percentage change in budget and for use in strategic planning. So attempted credits could be a replacement for FTSE in budgeting and strategic planning. It would count all enrolled credit hours, regardless of type of course. And our initial research shows that attempted credits have declined 1 to 2 percentage points, but we've updated that since this slide was done, somewhere between 1 and 4 percentage points less than basic term FTSE aggregated across all colleges. So rather than a 15% decline that our FTSE estimates indicate, it could be less in terms of tuition and fees to the tune of somewhere between 11 and 14%. So a little bit better look at our tuition and fees through use of credit hours rather than FTSE. So Elsa, if you could turn to the last slide, I think that concludes the presentation and we're available for more questions.
Thank you. I'm going to start with one key question, and maybe the white paper will address some of this. And I'm not clear to whom to direct this, meaning if it's you, Mr. Aquinto, Mr. Moore, or Dr. Gonzalez, maybe all three. That is, it's critically important that budgets align with strategic goals and thinking of the system as a whole. And as we explore these directions, and given that I haven't read the white paper yet, what was the alignment or what is the alignment that's being proposed or suggested to ensure that as you're looking at budget planning and budget and budgeting, particularly as we move into next year, that is part of the process?
And President Sullivan and Jim and Chancellor, if I could take a shot at that. It is addressed in the white paper, and it's addressed as follows, beginning with the Chancellor's Executive Committee early in the budget process in August. The CEC would identify its strategic priorities. What the next year's budget should embrace as investment priorities. That those list of investment priorities are then communicated to all the budget units in the late August, September time period. The budget office would then develop budget request forms that, excuse me.
I'm just losing
my voice a little bit, but
take some water, drink some water.
I got it. Thank you.
Okay, good.
So those priorities would be communicated to all the budget units, and the budget units would then develop their budget requests or their investment requests. Submit those to the budget office. The budget office would then compile all of those requests, and they would be vetted with, again, the CEC and all the senior councils before budget development the budget document is prepared and then shared with the board.
And I appreciate the execution option after you look at the strategic priorities that are established at the CEC. However, where I'm trying to go, maybe this is a question for you, Dr. Gonzalez, then, is what is the alignment with the system's strategic goals? I mean, certainly we haven't, I think it was pointed out last evening, done that work in 3 years. So how does that impact what is being proposed, particularly, for example, if we're looking at one of the disadvantages of the plan, one was delay in implementing innovation and new technologies. How, if the strategic goal of the system is to be challenged to look at doing work differently, for example, which would involve new technologies or certainly an embrace of different innovative practices and thought, and that's a strategic goal, then it seems to me that the disadvantage of the proposal shifts. And so if we're looking 2 years out, what is the link then to a strategic planning process to achieve those big strategic goals, not those isolated and then or starting at the CEC level, but those that are created in collaboration with the board, imagining the district's future?
President Sullivan, if I might try to respond to your question. From what I've seen from 1 year to the next in my position as president now, experiencing it differently from the interim chancellor's role, there's typically not a lot of difference in budget priority from 1 year to the next. If we've got five items that we're going to focus on from 1 year to the next, you may see some variation in that, and it largely depends on the accomplishment of those previous year's goals that are aligning towards the district strategic goals. And as you mentioned, and it was recognized yesterday evening during the work session, our district does need to spend some time revisiting the current strategic goals. We have a hard time identifying, and in our last HLC visit, they also expressed a difficulty in identifying what would be the district's strategic plan, whether that be a 3-year or 5-year plan. And so that's work that clearly needs to be done. It shouldn't prevent us from developing a new budget process, but somehow, some way, this has got to drop into an existing process. So if we can clean up how we come together and collaborate in developing a budget, we recognize that too, we need to make sure that we're aligning to the existing strategic goals. And secondly, as a system, we've got to develop a strategic plan, one that is is not just something that becomes a shelf document. The other thing that we need to do on top of that is to develop a mechanism by which we approach those goals and hold ourselves accountable to that. And some of our more recent weekly snapshots to the governing board, we've talked about the 4DX model as an example of how we might approach the achievement of whatever goals that we set in our district.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. All right. So I kind of took my questions first, so I'm going to go now backwards alphabetically. So Ms. Nguyen?
I don't have any further questions at this time. Thank you.
Dr. Thor?
Thank you, Ms. Sullivan. A couple questions. And you probably are anticipating I am going to ask that. But I'm troubled that we still do not have a compensation philosophy that is predictable and understandable. And I can't see how we can develop a 2-year budget until we first understand how we're going to compensate our employees. Then you mentioned the budget reallocation study or model that is intended to address the budgetary inequity between some of our colleges, and I hope that we're looking at the district office first. I'm personally frustrated at how long it has taken us to address the budgetary inequity, particularly at the newer colleges. And I'm now even further troubled at the recommendation that budget should be reduced 2-4% across all business units. Because for those colleges that are already inequitably budgeted, aren't we only making the situation worse? And then finally, I am delighted As you would guess, after nearly 20 years as president of Rio Salado, to see the recommended switch from FTSE to credit. And I hope also, as we're looking at those kinds of things, that we ask ourselves again why 45th day is important, given that we no longer get apportionment from the state. So those are my thoughts at this point in the process.
Could you, going back to the questions, Dr. Gonzalez, can you answer Dr. Thor's interest in the compensation plan status presentation?
Yes, President Sullivan, Dr. Thor, we do have a compensation philosophy work session scheduled for next month, where we have chosen to pick a time when we can dedicate an entire work session to that topic. So it's not lost upon us that that's a part of this conversation. I also I may have Dr. Kelly online who may be able to respond further to that, but that's all that I can take to it for now.
And President Sullivan, members of the board, Chancellor, this is Georgetta Kelly. In reference to that, you are correct, Dr. Gonzalez, we do have a whole work session dedicated to that. And also we are doing work, we entered into a contract with the Mercer Group this year to do the market analysis work and also to do an independent review to put forth, so that we may put forth policy for compensation, for enhancements to our compensation model. So we've been doing a lot of work in this area. Also, we've established a compensation advisory committee structure made up of the employees across the structure. So we'll be providing a brief overview of all of that information at the work session and be able to respond to the board's questions at that time. But we have completed the work in reference to the philosophy, and we definitely want input from the board so we can move that philosophy forward and make it livable across the organizational community, along with a sustainable pay plan.
And thank you. Do you, I don't have the schedule in my brain right in front of me. What date do we have that scheduled for? Dr. Gonzalez or Dr. Kelly?
I'm sorry, Ms. President Sullivan, I don't have that in front of me as either, but I can find that here quickly and get that back.
Okay, that'd be perfect. Thank you. So you made comments, Dr. Thor. Were there questions that came out of your comments that you wanted to ask outside of the compensation philosophy? Okay, I'm going to presume not. And so then, Dr. Nerini?
I don't have any questions, but I do appreciate and support Dr. Thor's comments on the compensation and the need for that for our employees.
Thank you. Then Mrs. McGrath?
How much money would we save if we went to one accreditation instead of 10 individual accreditations?
Ms. Sullivan, Ms. McGrath, I don't know, as I said here, but we can certainly look into that and come back with an estimate.
Thank you. I think that's a great idea.
Mr. Saar, I guess I went backwards just a little too fast. So coming back to you after Mrs. McGrath, do you have any further questions?
Hey, I'm here. Couple, you mentioned looking at real estate and I'm assuming on our campuses as well as off our normal campuses. My question takes that further into how we deliver content. That has changed dramatically in the last 12 months. I don't have any crystal ball to know what that's going to be like, you know, a year or 2 years from now. But I have a feeling that the online issues that we're dealing with now are working better than they did last March. They are in my personal case. And I'm thinking we probably need to spend some time as a board and as administration and others to determine what our physical needs are if we are going to have more of our courses being taught online. And to take that even further, when I said this before, when we offer strictly online classes, it really doesn't make any difference what college they're taking that class from. Now you can say, well, which one do they graduate from? But I don't have a problem with working those things out. So I think money can be saved if we look at, for example, what Rio considers its lowest enrollment requirement and its highest enrollment requirement for their online classes, and scale that across the district so that we make the best use of our online faculty going forward. I just feel real strong that life is going to change when it comes to content delivery, and we need to move along with the world and technology, especially to make sure that we're making the best use of all resources, not just the financial, but the time investment of our students and their investments in other things besides tuition and fees. There's obviously living between the time that they're in school and the time they're able to use that education to get a good job. We want to shorten that as much as possible. So I think there's lots of work that has to be done to make sure that all that is plan for the future, that we're not operating, as I've said many times in the past, trying to make that work in today's technology. It doesn't work. Thank you.
So then, Mrs. McGrath, did you have another question? I apologize. I wanted to make sure I didn't lose Mr. Saar in that.
No, I'm fine. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Hendricks.
No questions, but thank you.
Okay. Yes.
This is Stephen. In response to Dr. Thor's question of when the work session is scheduled, it is scheduled for October 13th.
Thank you.
Compensation philosophy. Thank you.
Okay. I forgot what day it was, and I didn't have that list in front of me. So thank you very much. Is there anything else that Dr. Moore, Mr. Quinto, Dr. Gonzalez, you would like to add to the formal presentation?
President Sullivan, members of the board, not at this time. As I said, this is just the very first conversation that we're having related to the fiscal year 22 budget cycle. And we look forward to continued conversation and collaboration with you and others throughout the district on its development.
Thank you. So to your point that there'll be a meeting in November, that we'll schedule that, the compensation philosophies next month. Just a reminder, both Ms. McGrath and I work as chairs, or our position to be a liaison for the budget committee in addition. So I think that's important to remember. Also, sending out the white paper to everyone, it would be beneficial to enhance our appreciation of the work that's been done and where these ideas that have been presented have been generated and determined. So with that, if there's nothing else, then I'm going to adjourn this work session. Thank you, business services, for your work and for all of those who have contributed on the task force and et cetera. A lot of thought obviously has gone into this, which is appreciated. And we'll look forward to the next steps as this continues to unfold. I'm going to remind board members and all other people in attendance that we are going to convene the regular meeting of the governing board at 6:30. And for purposes of the panelists, i.e. board members, it's not necessary for you to disconnect. If you do disconnect, you come right back. But otherwise, you can just stay, keep your stay online and be muted, and we'll talk to you all again about 6:30. So with that, any other questions before I absolutely close the meeting? Being done, I'll talk to you all at 6:30.